Namaste, members, guests who've joined us this Sunday for yet another session of ICDA's online series. Thank you so much to all of you, to all the members, and everyone who keeps these sessions going. I would also like to take a minute to say thank you to our founder, late Sri N. Gopakumar, for putting this group together and for giving us the conviction to move forward. We are extremely excited to have today's guest, a very, very beautiful dancer, a beautiful thinker as well. Let me introduce her in brief. Apoorva Jayaraman has a B.Sc. Honours in Physics from St. Stephen's, Delhi, a Master's degree from Oxford University, and a Ph.D. in Astronomy from Cambridge. But the heart pursued her love for dance, and after a decade of mainstream academics, this astrophysicist has turned into a full-time Bharatanatyam professional. Trained by Smt Kalanidhi Narayanan and by Smt Priyadarsini Govind, Apoorva is today one of the most sought-after dancer in the new age of Bharatanatyam. She travels across the world conducting workshops and performing, and has performed in some of the most prestigious venues across the world. We are extremely delighted to be hosting for you an evening with Apoorva Jayaraman. Apoorva, welcome to ICDA.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Reshma, for the very, very kind introduction, and also for having me on this forum. I think it's always so nice. It's a big learning for me every time I speak to fellow dancers. So I'm really looking forward to this session. Thank you all for joining in today. And yes, like Reshma said, let's keep this less as a monologue from my side and, interactive. So please feel free anytime you can, whether it's through the chat function or if you just want to speak up, I'd really love to hear your thoughts as well. It doesn't have to be questions, but even if you have comments or, anything that you'd like to share at any point, we don't have to leave it to the end. So today, the topic that, I decided to talk about, this idea of the Nayika of the Padabhadra, and making sense of her, trying to understand what this Nayika is, who this Nayika is. For me, it's not just been an academic exercise, so to say, but I think it's really been a product of my own personal journey, right? Where I started as a child, what were the kind of questions that I was asking when I learned my first Padavadnam? And today, sort of where I stand in that journey. And I think the interesting thing is that, unlike something like science, right? This is not, you don't have exact answers, but you have your ideas, sometimes you have your theories, and they evolve with time. So I think what I'm going to share with you today, in a way, is this journey that has brought me to wherever I am now. And I'm very excited about the way I think about the Padavarnam today, but I'm also very interested to hear your views, your thoughts on the Padavarnam as well, as a piece that has come to sort of become the centerpiece, right? The mainstay of the Bharatanatyam Margam, or at least has been the centerpiece of the Bharatanatyam Margam for a very, very long time now. So I'm just going to start off with a little audio visual that I'd like to play for you. Let me just start with that. I hope all of you can see my screen, and it's mainly an audio that way. Mm-hmm. Was mainly because to really impress upon the fact that every traditional Padavarna recurrently and almost insistently features a woman in love. And this woman seems fragile, languishing in the ache of some kind of unsatiated love, right? So whether it's from, you know, the 17th, 18th century compositions of the Tanjore Quartet, compositions like Sami Ninne Korina Nura, or all the way up to recent compositions of musicians like Lalgudi Jayaraman, Innum Yen Manam Ariyadavar Pol Irindidal Nyayama, the rhetoric is very clear. I seek you. Will you not pay heed? I'm tormented by this separation from you. When will you come to me? Right? And it's the same refrain that we find in every single Padavarnam that we take up. I suppose all of us at some point or another have vehemently questioned this pining Nayika, right? Let me know how many of you, if some of us may still be questioning it, but I'm quite certain that all of us who are engaged with the Varnam, yes, Reshma, we always ask this question saying, you know, Why is it that, you know, this woman who seems to be almost helpless is at the center of, you know, what we consider the main piece of Bharatanatyam itself, right? And somewhere I think this is also like the 21st century person in us who refuses to approve of the idea of a woman who can just wither away in love, right? And we're really unable to see any poetry in the idea of a woman sort of willingly languishing in this feeling, like almost as if she were savoring every moment of it. When I was a teenager, just beginning to learn some of these compositions, and of course, just beginning therefore to ask some of these questions, I was often faced with this very common answer that kept coming back to me from different avenues, and that was that the Piming Nayika is a metaphor for the Jivatma seeking the Paramatma. Now, this meant very little to a 13-year-old me, and 20 years back, growing up in the world of dance, and I suppose it's going to mean far less to any 13-year-old today. As a young student of dance, I was left very unconvinced about why the central story that I was telling was about a seemingly weak, helpless woman. Is this a sort of an outdated image of a woman that we are continuing to project through our dance? Are we glorifying a certain image of a woman which we ought not to be doing? And how, when I perform this, is this going to be relevant to my audience? And forget my audience, if it is not relevant to me in the first place, how am I going to make it relevant to my audience, right? And as often is the case with art, I think, and definitely most certainly true about the recent history of Bharatanatyam itself, right? We many, many times very happily, unthinkingly, unflinchingly filter away all those things which we convince ourselves is irrelevant. But in reality, maybe the truth there is just perhaps harder to get to. And maybe we simply haven't had the patience and the trust to stick it out and get to the core of it. And one of the most important things, I think, that happened to me very early on in my path as a young person in dance was having cultivated certain very valuable principles of learning. So it is great to ask questions. In fact, it is necessary to ask questions, right? Because that is the very fuel for one's process of learning and understanding and growing. And I'm very grateful for the fact that I grew up not ever thinking, any question that I ask is either a bad question, a stupid question, or an insolent question. No, all questions were valid. But as important as it is for one to ask questions and to challenge dearly held notions, it was as important as that to listen, right? And to seek the answers to these questions, which may or may not always be a ready-made answer, particularly in art, right? It may or may not be always something that is very apparent to us. And to get to answers which are not sometimes also necessarily simple or necessarily a this or that answer, right? It takes hard work. And it's easy to reject something simply because we don't understand it. But what I think I was made to realize when I was young is that you don't really have yet a sound judgment to reject something until you have really analyzed it, assessed it, and given it a fair chance, right? So even with all these many unanswered questions in my teenage mind, I stayed put. I continued to learn the Padavarnams and really apply myself to trying to understand how I can perform them to the best of my ability, right? But for many years after that, the Varnam to me more or less remained like a formality as part of the Marga. I don't think I really understood what I was doing with the Varnam. I still remember when I was about perhaps 12, 13 years old, I had learned a few non-traditional Varnams from my teacher then in Bangalore, Srimati Padmini Ravi. And she had done some interesting things, like she had taken a poem of Kabir and set it in the format of a Varnam. She had taken a Meera Bhajan and set it in the format of a Varnam. And I really, really enjoyed performing these pieces, right? I really loved dancing them. So almost always, I would opt to do one of these Varnams for any of the concerts that came up. And after about one or two concerts, when she used to ask me, what will you like to perform? And I will say, Ram Bhajan, Meera Bhajan for in place of the Varnam. And I remember after about a couple of instances of this, she told me in her, typical style in Tamil, she was like, she was like, you're not an old woman, why are you harping on this bhajan? But her point was, she was like, it's time to start presenting the real deal, right? And the real deal, according to her, was the traditional padavarnams, right? Now, once again, I think I was infused with the wisdom enough to realize that she perhaps sees a path that I don't see right now myself, right? And I didn't see the validity in that particular statement at that point of time, but I went with it. And I actually started performing what was the real deal. But just this idea, this statement, I think was something that really stuck with me, saying that why? Why is she referring to a Varnam as a Varnam? So then what, everything that I have learned must be on an equal footing. But why is it that she referred to these traditional Padavarnams as, really the meat of what we do? So that was something that stayed with me, right? And when I stepped into dancing professionally, right, many, many years, from this starting point, and began to take now my journey, not just of performing or executing this Varnam to the best of my ability, but also now attempting in general in dance to bring something to it of my own, right? And that was the effort that I was starting to make, turning a professional dancer. I went right back to these same questions, and perhaps now in a much, much more fundamental way. And I said, why is the Varnam, forget the Bhaini Nayika, why is the Varnam the centerpiece of the Bharatanatyam repertoire, right? I used to use these words, as a matter of fact, the centerpiece for today's recital, the mainstay for today's recital, etc. But, what made it the centerpiece? Why was I calling it the centerpiece? Is it the length of the piece? Is it because of the challenge that it gave you of, having to hold an audience together for, 40, 45 minutes, at least that's the length of the Varnams that we are performing today? Or was it simply because I was told that it was the centerpiece of the Margam, right? Or it was tradition that it was the centerpiece of the Margam. So we will continue to keep it as the centerpiece of the Margam. And this is actually a question that at this stage itself, I'd like to, pose to all of you, if, you can share with me, all of us take this for granted, right? Varnam is the most important piece of the Margam. But why? Why to you is the Varnam valid as the main piece of your concert presentation?
Can I?
Yes, please.
Ma'am, I think in Varnam, we can express our emotions, and Nritya and Nritya, both have a prominent, equal role in a Varnam, I guess.
Yes, definitely. Thank you. Thanks for sharing.
I want to elaborate on that. I feel that in a Varnam, when we present our idea, it can be like a lot of episodes or a lot of things can be spoken about vis-a-vis a padam. So just because of the length and the elaborateness of the whole item is, I feel that's why it takes center stage.
Yeah, sure.
There is a comment, Apoorva, on chat. This is from Malavika. And she suggests that there are a lot of elements involved in a Varnam, and hence it takes the center stage, and challenging parts like jatis and also the emoting part.
Nice. Lucky. So it's absolutely true that it's a piece that accords the most challenge to the dancer, right? Challenge physically, challenge in terms of stamina, challenge mentally to be able to sustain yourself, through multiple myriad things that is going on, right? From the start to finish of a Varnam. Absolutely, absolutely valid. And I think this is possibly, the area, the kind of answers that, I also grew up with in my mind. But somewhere along, this journey for me, some parallelly, some very different things were happening. And I think a few perspectives, new perspectives, started establishing for me. And it was through the lens of this that I was able to start revisiting the Varnam and kind of, you know, renegotiating with the idea of the Varnam itself. Shalini is adding, saying that, again, so many different kinds of emotions and, you know, the complexity of the jatis, etc. Absolutely, absolutely. So around this time was when I started my formal training of Abhinaya, study of Abhinaya under Smt Kalanidhi Narayanan and thereafter with my guru, Smt Priyadarsini Govind. And this sort of journey with Abhinaya and with this huge, infinite world of imagination that was offered by the body of Padams and Javalis is something that for me has, you know, continues to date, even today. And in beginning to sort of negotiate with this world, there were a few interesting things that happened in the sense that I was, brought to more questions that I was asking about dance, but the nature of these questions became a little subtler, right? So I think I first of all started having a more nuanced understanding of what it means to find conviction in what I'm doing, right? Finding conviction could mean asking, is this possible, right? Rather than, would I do this, for instance? Asking, what means... Right. So the nature of the questions, what did it mean for me to be convinced about the Nayika I was playing in a Padam, for instance? So asking what makes a person react in a certain way, right? Instead of, why did this person react in this way, right? I would not have chosen to do the same thing. If I was in this situation, I would not do that. I disapprove, right? And this is a very, very important difference in terms of, does my conviction in content come based on my personal preferences and my personal beliefs, right? So that is more a sense of approving or disapproving of content and saying that, no, this isn't me, right? Or this isn't correct, right? So I'm bringing my own judgment to it versus asking whether this is possible. Is this an alternate reality that is possible? Do people like this exist, right? What makes people respond in a certain way in a certain situation, right? And giving that sort of a chance. And this became extremely important, particularly, you know, with respect to the range, the beautiful range of personalities and emotions that this body of Padamjavali literature was throwing up to me. Again, at this same age, when I was pretty much 14, 15, right? And beginning to negotiate with compositions like this. And to give you an example, you know, there is a Sarangapani Padam that I learned, which the first line says, Vakkathaina Aasaledu Gadave, Vani Chelimi Kokka Dandame, right? And the meaning of this is, he is not even worth a penny, a grain of rice he is not worth. What is the point in having a relationship with him? It's all, and you know, Dandam, even in Tamil, in Telugu, it's like saying, oh, Baba, enough, I've had enough of him, please. Right? Let's get rid of this person. Now, if I decide to perform this padam, does it mean that I am approving of a particular choice that the Nayika has made? Or does this mean that, you know, I in my own life will make a similar choice, right, regarding my relationship? Or can I understand that irrespective of the fact that this is a composition that has come from a certain cultural milieu and also a certain period, that there is validity to the existence of a person of this nature? There could be a woman who thinks this way, even in today's times. I don't think it's something that we necessarily have to attribute only to a period or a certain, you know, a professional association necessarily, okay? another example, and I'm also taking up examples which I always found a challenge in the beginning, right? In terms of where I always ask, what is this? I don't want to play this character. For instance, Chitike Vesite, Chetreya's Padam, right? Where this man who says, oh, if I snap my finger, there will be 100 women like you who will come and stand behind me. What do you think of yourself? You think you're too smart, right? And who is he talking to? He's talking to a woman who has rejected his advances, right? Now, question I need to ask is, just in playing this character, does it mean that I'm automatically glorifying the character? Does it mean that I'm ratifying the behavior of the character? Does it mean I'm making a statement about this is okay, this is cool? Now, that all of that comes into the background of how you take this padam, how you treat this padam, etc., right? But it is not just in choosing to do the padam itself, I have established that, you know, yes, I approve of this kind of behavior. And this is what, you know, it happens in real life as well, right? So there's that kind of a subtle difference that I began to make for my own self. And it is not something that is, you know, set in stone. It's not an exercise that is complete for me at all. Even today, every new composition that comes up, I think I have to go back and revisit these same questions and ask, you know, at what level am I bringing in my personal opinions, biases, judgments into this padam? How much can I extricate all of that, right, from the padam before I can actually address it and play it? And after this process happens, how do I address it? What kind of treatment do I want to give this padam, right? And this actually brings brought me also to a much heavier question in art, which is, what is actually my responsibility as an artist? I think it really brings it down to that also. Is my responsibility as an artist to preach, to tell people what my sense of right and wrong is, or to tell people what to believe? What is my responsibility as an artist? And I think this is a question that I'm still answering. It is not something that, you know, I have an answer to, but this is something that I want to leave with all of you, you know, probably that we can sort of discuss that at the, you know, end of the talk, because it really boils down from there, right? Once you peg that answer for yourself and saying, okay, this is what I am meant to be doing as an artist, then all the other answers really take its source from there, right? But and it's I think a very nuanced question for all of us as artists to think about. Nevertheless, so one was this idea of conviction, right? What does it mean to be convinced about something? The second is the idea of relevance, right? In the beginning, I told you one of my major issues was, you know, this tiny woman is not relevant to me itself. And how am I going to make an audience sit and watch me doing this finding Nayika in the first place, right? But I think this question of something being outdated is something that we have to engage meaningfully, especially in today's times, where everything from the kind of art we consume, the kind of clothes we wear, you know, the kind of influences that we grew up with, are so different from what is traditionally woven into our choreographies, right? And this is, I think, a unique time that we are standing in, because perhaps about 100, 150, 200 years back, there wasn't much disparity between how people lived their lives and what they were talking about or presenting in their dance. So it was not a dichotomy that necessarily, you know, our sort of predecessors in dance faced. But it's a very, very active dichotomy that all of us face now, right? Because your dance is showing you motives like, you know, putting kolam, drawing water from the well, wearing a sari. But, you know, it's very easy for me to argue and say, hey, but all of that is outdated. You know, I don't do any of that anymore. So, and therefore, what I'm doing is irrelevant, right? I think more than ever, it's extremely important for us to think about and consider what actually makes something relevant or not, right? Especially for those of us who are teachers, because it is also a responsibility in terms of what we are communicating can really sway, you know, the direction of the form and you know, how young people begin to view this, right? To me, relevance is when I ask a question like, will a woman experience love for a partner any differently today? Will she feel any less restless, when separated from her partner, for instance? Or will she feel any less betrayed when she discovers that she's, her partner has cheated on her, for instance, right? And the answer to all of these questions is most likely no. The way you experience an emotion, what you feel in a situation, is not something that changes. And I'm talking about emotional responses, right? These are not opinions that you hold. But the way you emotionally respond in a situation remains the same. And the point of whether I am, drawing a column or I'm working on my laptop when this particular incident happens or a particular news arrives is immaterial. That is literally just your, ambience. That is your geography. And it's, yes, you can do what you want with it, but that is not where the relevance of our performance lies, right? Sure, I can change putting column to some other activity, but does that mean I have immediately become relevant to my audience? No, because it is in finding that emotion, it is in touching that, the real sense of what is the experience this person is having, even touching that, I become relevant to my audience, because in all likelihood, all of your audience has a memory of the same kind of an experience or has an understanding of what it means to be in that situation, right? As human beings, we all have empathy. So even if I haven't been in love, I can understand someone else's intense love or desire, right? So I think just casting this sort of relevance question in the right way, it's really, it boils down to asking the questions in the right way, right? And the answers kind of emerge on their own. And the other, for me also, one very ironic thing is, I think I heard of some of these things, while I was growing up in dance as a child, and sometimes I see that some of us are, probably saying the same things to our younger ones and our students today, particularly in India, when it comes to this idea of feeling shy, right? Very common thing, any young kid will ask you, why should I feel shy looking at a boy? Does not make sense to me at all. The moment our response is, because in those days, they used to feel shy. Nowadays, girls do not know how to feel shy, right? We've all changed, we've all become modern. It's actually, if we stop for a moment to think about it, it's a misleading answer. And it's also a very unhelpful answer at the end of the day, because you're reiterating the concept in that young person's mind that this emotion is outdated. But how can that be? Isn't that the emotion that all of us have a capacity for, all of us? This is not girl, boy, irrespective of age. It is a fundamental emotion that we all either feel or definitely have a capacity to feel. What has changed over time is, once again, the way we express ourselves, right? So yes, where we lose that a point of relevance, perhaps, while communicating this idea to a student is, when I say, oh, do that. Yeah, then the question would be, no, I don't do that when I see a boy, right? That's not the way I express what I feel. Even though, right, you have the same blood rushing to your cheeks if you see a boy you really like, yeah? So separating out the core, which is the emotion and which is timeless, which cannot be touched by anything else that you discuss, from how it is expressed. And when we create the moment the separation is created, it honestly doesn't matter how we express. You place it in any period, it's fine. It's absolutely fine. So far as, you can find an aesthetic way to create that certain image for your audience. But the moment this separation has happened, what we will insist on is the sense of the emotion, right? You stop insisting on the particular body language or the particular way of expressing on it. So once again, I think just the way these questions are placed, and that was a very, very important thing that started happening for me through the body of the Padamjali literature. And finally, there's another thing that happened apart from my Abhinaya training at this point, which is interesting for me, because I, at some point, really started enjoying performing the work. And I really started relishing watching Varnams in performance. I started loving the musicality of some of these, you know, traditional pieces, so much so that I felt good dancing them. I wanted to dance them, right? And at the same time, I was also watching a lot of alternate attempts as well in terms of the non-traditional Varnams, right? Trying to talk about different topics rather than the Paini Nayika. I was watching some of this, but somehow I wasn't really convinced by what I was seeing. These attempts didn't really speak to me. And I found myself, without having an analytical or an intellectual conviction about, you know, why these Varnams were creating this response in me, I found myself going back to the traditional Padavarnams, and I understood that statement, like I empathized with the statement of, you know, nothing like the tanjo quartet Padavarnams, right? Which is something that we hear so often. I'm like, yes, I feel it, but I was nowhere sort of different from understanding through my conscious mind what had created this change, right? But it was in a more of an embodied understanding had definitely started. So it was almost like my body was taking in the delight of doing these Varnams, but mind hadn't sort of caught up yet, right? And I'm saying this for, reason I'm sharing this is also important because this is from the 13-year-old me to probably like the 23-year-old or the 25-year-old me. Now, 10 years down the line, I don't necessarily have more answers, you know, than I already had. I probably have far more questions than I had, but some journey has taken place, right? And you need time and trust to allow that journey to take place. And if you're too impatient, you know, for the answer, or if we expect the answer to be handed to us, you know, right there saying, hey, this is what it is. And in the absence of that, right, if there is a plain dissatisfaction and we say, okay, I'm not going to ever perform this Varnam, then it's actually a very, very beautiful journey that we miss out on, right? And that's the reason why I'm sharing this. So what was really different for me between these two experiences? So being a teenager, liking the non-traditional Varnams, absolutely not enjoying the traditional ones, and that completely flipping over for me in about, you know, 10 years time, right? Now, all the Padams and Javalis, once again, you know, my entry point has always been through that world. The bulk, I mean, they found the bulk of the Abhinaya repertoire in Bharatanatyam, right? And they always have a well-defined protagonist at their center, a well-defined character who speaks in first person at their center. So, and in many of these Padams, the person who is being spoken to is almost incidental. And I say this with great care. The person who is being spoken to in most of these Padams would be Krishna, Venkatesha, basically deities, right? So what do I mean when I say then they're deities, but they're incidental? None of these Padams you will find will go into any kind of Puranic references, any detailed references beyond a certain, you know, attribute and the name of the character that is being spoken to. And the center stage of these Padams is not about the person who is being spoken to, right? It's in a way the focus or the spotlight of the Padams comes back onto the person who is speaking. Irrespective. So you will find, you know, in these Padams, if you actually replace, you know, one deity with another, it doesn't dramatically change the situation or the emotion that this protagonist is feeling at all, right? And that's what I mean by the choice is perhaps in that incident. Is there a question or something? So now the focus, instead of being on the object of interest, is shifts on to the Nayika, who is the protagonist, right? And although a seemingly very simple thing, in shifting the focus from the one that is being spoken to the one who is speaking, something actually very powerful had already happened in my mind, right? And as Padam after Padam after Padam was reiterating this to me, now, once again, how I started asking the question changed. So what is our complaint usually about the pining Nayika anyway, right? It is always, why should a woman pine for a man? A man who has shown little regard to her, a man who has left her never to return, a man who is like toying with her emotions. So our immediate response is always, he's not worth this pain. He's not worth all of this, trouble, emotional turmoil that you're going through. But these are, first of all, my problems to start with, right? Personally, my Apoorva's problems to start with first. Part of the problem is already obliterated if I shift the spotlight on the Nayika, because then now I simply accord her the respect of a certain agency to feel a certain way. And I can flip the question around to ask, why shouldn't she pine? Why shouldn't she desire so intensely so as to pine? Right? It is not, so it's just that perspective that sort of shifts in your head. Now we find Meera extremely poetic, right? Her object of interest was this idea, in my understanding, not a man, but an idea called Krishna. And we find Meera extremely fascinating, and her mad, blind sort of passion in her pursuit of this idea is something that we, look at with a certain, distant admiration almost, right? We find Andal extremely poetic, and the object of interest for Andal was this idea called Vishnu. We find Akka Mahadevi poetic, right? Now, I may never personally choose to live the life of a Meera or an Akka Mahadevi or an Andal, but that doesn't make their lives or even the purpose of their existence invalid or even irrelevant in any way at all. So specifically in the context of the Padavarnam, once again, the Nayika-centric approach shifts the focus from the man-woman relationship to simply the capacity of intense passion, I think human beings harbor, right? So you're shifting the focus onto the passions of the individual, the feeling, the emotion of the individual, irrespective of the object of desire. And so when we ask who is a Varnam about, it is not about, Trivarur Tyagesha or about, Tanjay Brihadeshwara. It is about the Nayika. And really what comes into focus immediately is this capacity of a human being to harbor an unquenching desire, an almost unreasonable passion sometimes, right? That urges one never to give up. You want to keep moving towards that one thing that you desire. And the moment you take this object of desire out of the picture, it is not even about desire for a person, right? Or love for a person. It simply becomes a kind of a compelling quest for purpose, right? So now this understanding began to influence how I understood parts, elements of what I was performing as well, right? So I'd like to play for you now just an excerpt from Subram Dikshitar Varnam in Khamas. And I'm going to play the Sanchari of the Anupadam. So most Anupallavis of Padavarnas always state who the object of desire is. It's a very common format that is followed in these verses. So this Anupallavi also states who the Nayika is talking about. Okay. But what do I do with that line? When I know that, okay, this is the deity that is being spoken about, where should my focus in expanding out that line be? Okay, so let me just play that video first, and then I will. So, sorry, the words before I play it. The words in this are Mundu Kegu Veera Vasanta Tyagaraja Swami. Okay. The one who comes in procession in front of me, Veera Vasanta, the courageous, the valorous, the beautiful Tyagaraja Swami. That's all. That's all that the line says. Okay. Interesting comments that I received after this particular performance, in fact, of this sanchari is someone told me that, you know, your the Varnam is very beautiful, but it could have been very nice had you dwelt more on the deity, right? On the beauty, on the attributes of the deity himself. Now, at that time, this is again, you know, the first time I did this was probably 2014 or 15. I took that as a comment, something to think about. But a few years down the line today, I'm convinced that I would still do this sanchari the way it was originally set, right? Where the focus is on the Nayika watching this brilliant deity in procession, but the intention of the Varnam is not to praise or to describe or to create the sort of the aura of the object of desire, right? And does this make sense to you, what I'm saying? Because this, the desire that we're talking about here and the quest that we're talking about here is not arising because it is the particular Tyagaraja Swami of a particular temple, right? And that's what I mean by, in another Varnam, there will be the same intense desire that is felt for, you know, the same Shiva, but who resides in another temple, right? Understanding sort of the larger context of the Varnam then started putting elements of the Varnam, first of all, right, portions, independent portions, in perspective and making sense of it. Okay, I want to show you one more Sanchari from a much more recent Varnam that I have performed, where I learned this Varnam again many years back, but the Sanchari in the second half, this is the Navaraga Malika Varnam, where the second half says, Sada ninaivu kondu mayyal meerude Shankara Bharanane. Okay, Sada ninaivu kondu, incessantly thinking about him, mayyal meerude, right? I feel a certain intoxication, a certain mayakam. Who? Shankara Bharanane. Who is Shiva, another word for, another name for Lord Shiva. Okay. So in this Sanchari, you will find that we go into a little more of a detail of the description of Shiva. Okay. So it's not that, okay, you don't describe. Oh, never describe the deity is not the idea. But you describe the deity, keeping in mind that you're doing it for what purpose? You're doing it for the purpose of what effect it creates on the protagonist, the one who is speaking. So even though all physical attributes of Shiva is described, the focus is kept on what kind of an effect, what effect does it have on this person, Mayal Mirude, a certain intoxication at all times. Okay, so I'll just play that. Are the videos reasonably clear for all of you? I hope that it's not, the streaming of it isn't too bad. Is it okay?
It's okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Nom 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 n Maybe by mistake she left the meeting. In a way, this is also beautiful, right? We are able to think about whatever we have just seen and relish it. Oh my God.
Oh my God. Amazing.
Nicola, where have you joined from?
I'm from Italy.
Wonderful. Lovely to have you here.
Thank you. It's wonderful.
And if you would like to be part of ICDA, please do hand over your number. We can add you to one of the WhatsApp groups. You get to hear regularly from people.
Oh, thank you.
Every Sunday mostly.
Thank you.
Not only for Nicola, for all who have joined for the first time, please do share your number in the WhatsApp group.
I don't even know what happened.
Sorry about that. Oh, please. What we were thinking is we had a few minutes to just think and relish whatever we have just seen. So it was amazing in disguise. That's fine.
I seem to have lost the chat as well in having rejoined, but I know there were a few comments which I thought I'll take later, but yeah, nevertheless. So, that was just to kind of, take a closer look at. So both of the sanctuaries that I showed you are choreographies of my teacher, of Priyadarsini Govind. And in simply, what I'm trying to bring attention to is in simply trying to analyze, right, the structure of the Varnam and the structure of the dance composition, there is so much information or so much insight one can get, right, in terms of, what it is that we are doing with the Varnam. And I think this is precisely the change that happened for me that converted, right, this, like pieces of the puzzle started falling in place. So everything started looking, feeling more organic in a sense. And perhaps that is why I started enjoying performing the Varnam more without initially understanding what had sort of, initiated that change. And hopefully if we have the time, I'd also like to show you sort of a comparison of, for me, what the Varnam was and, what it has sort of become today. But what I'd like to now do going forward is quickly visit now elements of the Varnam itself. And I feel that's what I'm trying to get at, right? Whatever insights that or whatever ideas or ways of thinking about the Varnam that today I have is not from anything external to the practice of dance at all. The information is all right there in what we do. It's staring right at us. It's a question of, whether, like I said, we allow the time for it to speak to us, right? And for it to reveal sort of what it has to say. So just want to start with a very basic thing. Now in a padam, what do I do in the beginning of a padam? I always create a scene, right? There is, a Nayika is probably getting dressed. She's waiting for the, her partner to arrive. Or, there is a scene, a landscape setting that we create for the padam, etc. Right? We always create a prelude for the padam. But what do we do in the beginning of the varnam? We start with them. Attami, right? And as much as we talk about the importance of the sthayi bhava, we actually don't even remotely touch the sthayi bhava as a dancer until we have, after we have finished the trikalajati, right? We start with as neutral a kind of a temperament as possible. Now, something to think about here already. One piece of information where, is it by chance? Again, and this is something that I keep coming back to, right? Something that has survived and come down to us over definitely, in this case, 100, 200 years. We cannot trace it perhaps, you know, longer than that, you know, further back than that in terms of how it was practiced. But even if something has survived 100 years, wouldn't there be some validity to that practice? Or is it just that all of us are so blindly, you know, okay, I have to start Varnamidha Natani and I'm starting Varnamidha Atani. Is there any questions? Sorry. Yeah, so let's keep that in mind, right? You start neutral. You don't start by creating any kind of a sort of a setting whatsoever. Now, once again, if you come back to this idea of who she's speaking to, without considering the identity of the person, that's not what I want to focus on. A Varnam to me has always felt, in a very heartbreaking way, it feels like a soliloquy. It doesn't feel like a conversation to me. When I dance the Varnam, I don't feel like I'm talking to somebody, even the Sakhi. You forget the, you know, the hero or the deity, right? Even when you're having that conversation of the Sakhi. Now, yes, in Padams as well, the chief voice or the main voice that you see or hear is always that of the Nayika or the protagonist in concern. But through that protagonist's voice, you get to see the other person. You get to see the other characters who are involved in that conversation. And it is very, very evidently in its treatment a conversation that is happening in the moment. But in its treatment, in the way we treat the Varnam, a lot of things that we take, once again, it's just there, it's there in our practice, and we do it, including using a lot more Angika Abhinaya for Varnam, right? Using a lot more of your body in every single movement that you create in a Varnam, right? And in how we construct the sentences. So this was, again, something that was a great... I just kept doing it for a long time, but you know, there is a moment when you see this, and it's a very, very fascinating sort of an understanding when you see it, right? So I just like to take an example of, say, one line, okay? And how do we do it differently between a Padam and a Varnam? So I'll take one line from, which sort of mean the similar thing from a Padam and from a Varnam. So, the Yantanine Varnam in Khamas, okay, has a line in the Charanam which says, Kopa Mera Kaugi Lira Korinavaramu Lira. Okay, Kopa Mera, why this anger? Kaugi Lira, embrace me now. Korinavaramu Lira, grant me the boon that I ask. Okay, so now what do I mean by the difference between it being a conversation versus not, was it being a monologue, where there is just an appeal that is being sent into the space almost, right? Without talking to the person in front of me, okay? So, if I did this in my Varnam, okay? For instance, I would do... Kopa mera kauki lira Korina varamu lira. Okay, this is an example. I've just done a padartham version of it. But if I want to do the same thing as a conversation, in what way does it change? Right? So
kopa mera kauki lira Korina varamu lira.
Okay, so kopamu having this anger, there is a visual picture that I'm creating in front of me, right? Of the person standing there looking at me in anger versus a understanding that, oh, this this, I have not attained this object of desire. This, I have not seen this person whom I desire, perhaps because he is angry with me. He is angry with me, right? So, why are you angry with me? Which doesn't have a sense of, why are you angry with me? Won't you tell me? Come on. Won't you embrace me? Come. Give what I ask, right? Where there is space for the person opposite you to enter the conversation, right? I don't know if I was able to demonstrate it in a manner that there is the separation between the two is clear. But this is something, once again, just from having, you know, done it so many times, and you don't actively ask that question, right? But it's already there. It's a very, a Varnam is a solidity. It is not something that even when I do, you know, that he, please go, please bring him. There is no space that I'm giving her to necessarily come so much into the conversation, if you see what I mean. Even the Sakhi perhaps has a little bit of a leeway when it comes to that, but definitely the object of desire does not have that particular idea, right? So now, once again, then it brings me back to the question, then who is this Nayika? Why this difference? It's seemingly the same idea, right? You will have padam lines that start with, you know, why are you angry with me? Why are you acting so smart? It's the same line in a Varnam. Why is this difference that gets created, right? Now, even in a padam, this grammar of this whole Nayika genre is characterized by a sense of, like, a very unique quality that the person that you're playing, the protagonist that you're playing, is a nameless entity, right? What I mean by that is, someone is not telling me that you are Sita, you are Draupadi, you are Radha, right? Well, then this is a clearly etched character by some literature or the other. Some kind of reference I have to go, you know, back to and say, okay, this is what Sita's attributes were. But in most of the padams, if I say, you know, Inilu Vachitivya, who is this woman? She's a nameless woman, right? I don't have a certain personality, you know, trait and a set of characteristics to go back to be able to play this woman. So in this case, what are the kind of questions that we're asking? How angry is she? She's a Khandita Nayika. What is the degree of her anger? I have to make a decision about it, okay? Whereas instead, if I ask you, you know, similarly, oh, how much did Sita suffer? Or how much did Draupadi suffer? You almost have a sense of that magnitude from the literature that you, the situation in the literature and how this person responds, right? But not so in a padam. Now, in this anger, is she going to hold her own or is she going to break down, okay, because of the situation that has been created? Is she going to be abusive towards the hero or, you know, is she going to choose rather to be a little sarcastic and navigate him? Now, where do I get all this information? All this information is suggested to me by the lyrics of the padam in one form or another. It may not be in an obvious way which tells me the woman is this old, this is her background, so on and so forth, but simply in the kind of language that is used, right? The choice of the words, the flavor of the words, this information is there for you to pay heed to. But what about the Varnam Nayika? I'd like you to take a moment and think about any Varnam that you are familiar with, Varnams that you are familiar with. The one thing that we, you know, doesn't hit us in that sense is that the Nayika is most often not given any attributes. The lyrics do not give you a sense of, oh, you know, she's a very, very young, you know, girl, or she's a very mature person, she's a very sophisticated person, she's a very crass person, you know. Look at the language of the Padavarnams. There is a certain uniformity, whether it is Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam. There is a certain formality, okay, and a uniformity in the kind of language and the choice of words and the flavor of words. And it, while the focus is completely on what the person is feeling, they never tell you who this person is, what kind of a person this person is. And which is why when we see a Varnam Nayika, do we, you know, we don't see, oh, bold Nayika, oh, you know, this Nayika, silly Nayika. You don't see flavors like that, right, of the Nayika, which is why we come back always to describing the Nayika as spiny, because that is the one thing that hits us. The feeling, the sense of the Nayika is the one thing that hits us, right? And this sort of complete lack of, once again, complete lack of reference to physicality, personality, etc., consistently over Padavarnams, is this an accident or is this by choice, right? And for me, the one idea that it's this sort of, you know, posed to me or made me think of is, could this Nayika, this person, right, who I'm trying to play, actually be me, the dancer, in this case? Could it be? Is it that the voice that is waiting to be discovered over here through this piece is actually mine and not another nameless character, but it is something for the first time this sort of metaphor allows each dancer to own in a way, instead of inhabit the voice. So the voice becomes yours. You are not occupying the voice of someone else, but it is becoming your own voice, or it has potential to become your own voice, right? And the thing is, so in a way, it compels us to project our own personal quests, our personal longings, our personal journey towards purpose onto this framework, okay, which at the same time is absolutely fascinating, right, and almost also terrifying at the same time, right? There is a bridge that you're creating between now the character that you are putting out on stage and your own journey, right? It's a much tougher ask in so many which ways, right? But what's interesting again is the grammar that the entire system gives us. So the source from where I bring out this feeling has to be intensely personal, definitely, right? But the account cannot be autobiographical. I cannot stop talking about my problems, oh, you know, that day when this happened, or this is what I seek and I'm unable to attain it, right? Why can I not do that? The moment I start engaging in the specifics of my own life circumstance, or even then start indulging in my own personal mannerisms, personal personality traits, once again, personal choices that I would make or not make, it becomes my story. Why is it that anybody or every single person in my audience, right, will most likely have their own quest for meaning and purpose, right? We're all, as human beings, meaning-seeking creatures at the end of the day. And it's perhaps that one line of thought that is going to create maximum resonance with our audience, right? But if I make it an autobiographical account, I'm losing the sense of resonance. So what happens is that you want to pair off the personality characteristics, right? The personal stories. But so now the focus, much more so from the personality, shifts only and only to what is being felt. So when I see a Varnam Nayika, why do I refer to her as pining, pining, pining? Because that is what the focus of the piece is. It is not who that woman is, what, you know, why is she pining? What is this? You know, who is this man who left her and went? You know, why is she being silly? But the focus that I want to bring attention on is on that sense of, what do you say? That capacity to desire something, right? And the thing is, to me, that quest could be dance, right? To someone else, that quest could be sport or music or science or just anything at all, or, you know, a person in your life. Any of this could be the quest. But in having sort of brought this whole picture to a common space and a metaphor, you're creating the potential to speak to this very, very fundamental, drive that all of us have, and speak also about something that is very fundamental to human beings without distancing, you know, yourself or the story from the audience at all. right? And just this possibility that we could be, again, this is just my like crazy idea, could be, right? Just my way of right now, this is kind of what convinces me. But just this thought that the centerpiece, the main piece of the Bharatanatyam Margam could be talking about something that is so fundamental to all of us as human beings, something that goes beyond, you know, you're not talking about period, you're not talking about cultural milieu, you're not talking about do you understand this kind of situation in your culture versus my culture. It is something that universally every single person actually lives for. You live to find purpose ultimately, and you're constantly moving every day to kind of realize what your own purpose in life is, right? And it was a very, very fascinating moment for me that everything just suddenly fell in place. I said, oh my God, I mean, yes, then I want the Varnam to be the main piece of my Margam, right? It makes me, it now then makes me want to make sure that my audience is not bored for 40 minutes, but they get, right? They understand the context in which it is coming, because it is potentially something they can resonate with, right? That is, it's just not situational at all. And what happened then is a lot of other, you know, maybe smaller questions that we always ask around this also started falling into place for me, right? Can boys do padavarnams? When boys do padavarnams, should they do it as a heroine or should they do it as a hero? Now, dare I say, if this Nayika is in a sense embodied by you, if the Nayika is a vehicle to evoke this common human quest, then in a way, she is already a genderless entity, right? Gender doesn't even come into the question after that. It is immaterial whether you refer to this protagonist then as this or that or anything, right? Because you're bringing the focus on the feeling. So then why should, you know, boys deal with this issue of, you know, but should I do some other non-traditional padavarnam? Because the traditional padavarnams, you know, are centered around a female character, that argument completely gets taken away, right? Now, the other thing is also about jatis. Why jatis? Why do we have jatis in this? This is something that I've heard many people ask, saying it completely breaks the emotional flow of, you know, when you're getting into a certain emotion, suddenly you break into a jati, right? What sense does that mean? But again, if I'm creating a narrative kind of a situation, okay? Or if I'm talking about a conversation that I'm having in this moment, saying, oh, you know, you cheated on me, right? I'm angry on you, for instance. It would make absolutely no sense for me to break into dance in the middle of it and come back and carry on that conversation, okay? But if what I'm talking about is this quest for purpose, in life, that's what I do, no? For me, dance may be my quest. It is, of course, something that underlines every single thing that I do in my life, but that doesn't mean it is at the forefront of my thought all the time. I eat, I sleep, I do other things, I have vacations, right? And I also pursue this one thing that gives me great joy or gives me a sense of meaning in life. So if the Varnam then takes this form for you, the jatis absolutely makes sense, because you have to give relief. This is not a conversation that is happening in a moment in time, right? But there is a certain, you know, intransience to this whole thing. It is a quest for life. And, you know, the moment we hit that point, the moment we feel we've found that point, right? Or found that union, the story is over. The journey is over, right? So it is actually a journey that never ends, that never completes itself. So why do we start neutral with the atomy? Makes sense. Why do Varnams have conclusions? No. There are, nowadays we have Varnams where, you know, we end with the Charanam line, right? The tendency nowadays is to always come back to the main Charanam line and finish. But I've also heard that in the past, they used to come back to the Pallavi line and finish. That was also a practice. But irrespective of when, so if I'm doing, say, Indendu Achitivira, Aladani illu ee veedi kaadu popora. Okay, why have you come here today? That woman's house is not here. Please leave is the Pallavi line of a padam. So when I finish with the Pallavi line, I have made a very clear conclusive statement. Get lost. Please leave. Conclusion has been created with your in coming back to the Pallavi. But what happens if I come back to the Pallavi line of a Varnam or even the Charana line of the Varnam? Oh Lord, I long for you, right? I seek you. I feel this intense desire that I cannot control. So even when you look back to the beginning, you're kind of where you started, right? But in a sense of like the intensity of this thought has built over time, right? So you don't create a conclusion in Varnam, right? I mean, very, very rarely I have seen, you know, interpretations where the Lord appears and then there is union. Rarely, actually, right? We always tend to finish it off and taper off with that viraha and with that sense of separation and longing itself. Again, not a matter of chance, right? It's completely by choice. Whether now, in terms of where do we go from here with this, right? We can definitely, one very valid question that we can ask is, why should love be the metaphor? Ultimately, the metaphor that has been picked by most of these poets is in the form of a relationship of love, right? A physical love that I feel towards somebody else. That is the metaphor that has been picked. And perhaps because it is one of the most universal emotions, I don't know. What is the reason, right? Why did poets choose this as their main metaphor consistently? Perhaps because it allows us much more easily to go into a shared emotional landscape, right? With your audience and with people around you. Because any other quest that I take as a metaphor may single out a certain section of an audience based on their interest. But love is perhaps something that sort of creates that framework for you for you to transcend, right? From something that is specific to something that is not generic, but something that resonates with everyone, right? And while we expand, so it brought me back to all those non-traditional Varnams that I really enjoyed earlier on, and also the question of why was I not in the similar manner enjoying non-traditional Varnams anymore. I think there is still capacity for us to create new possibilities and new metaphors that will still kind of create this effect that we desire. But just having a sense of that larger context changes or influences the kind of choices that we make, right? So I, for instance, with this context that I have, would not choose anymore to string together a bunch of stories about Krishna into a Varnam form, for instance, right? I wouldn't choose to break down any other form of poem, right, into single lines and create them into a, right? Because the format is not just in the jati, abhinaya, jati, abhinaya, jati, abhinaya. That is not the format, right? The format is in the purpose that it is serving as well. So I think having that kind of a larger understanding that influences the choices that you're making, right? So just for that, I will play another Sanchari from, this is also a Kamas Varnam, the audio of which was part of the medley in the beginning. Mamo halahiri nirude, yenese guvin. So there is one line in this Varnam which says, Valiyavanalu poi varavenu. Okay. Even if it is something on my own accord, even if it is something that I have to do, one has to go. One has to, go. Now, the sentence just leaves it as one has to go, right? Of course, the lyrics that come before, after, completes the picture in terms of, you know, to this object of desire, to this deity that she's talking about. But, just to address this idea of using love or using Shringaram as the metaphor in expanding lines such as this. Okay, let me just play that for you. That, you know, really stood out in terms of choreography and what it was saying, right? Seemingly very small things. The Nayika is talking to a friend, okay, in this case. But there is a one hand where she looks for, so valiya analu poi varavenum is a neutral statement in the sense that one has to go. But who has to go in this case? Who can go, right? So there is one hand which is looking for who do I send? She's actually having a conversation with a friend, right? But the fact is that you cannot send anybody on this quest of yours, right? I am alone in this quest. I have to go myself, right? And the other thing for me, this is a very personal thing, right? The tendency to leave the metaphor and to move towards what the metaphor references is actually a very high tendency for me personally. And it's something that Priyanti keeps, you know, pointing me towards and, you know, bringing me back, like pulling me back from that, right? So when sancharis are expanded, I keep the metaphor of Shringaram alive, right? It's the same thing that we spoke about. It's important for you not to become the thing that is being pointed at, right? But to be the pointer as the dancer. What I can do as a dancer is hold that, you know, sort of arrow towards that is what we're talking about. But if as a dancer, if I become that or I start talking about that which I am pointing to, you're again making it specific, right? And you're losing the sense of, you're losing the ability for that to speak beyond a certain section of the audience. Does that make sense? And this is something that I always have a tendency to do when I'm trying to create new work. I get very specific. I get very, like, to the point with the dance, right? But that's not, that is not in a way, it is also not the nature of the art form, and it is not the purpose of the art form as well, right? It is not to give a talk or, you know, make a point or give a conclusion, but to point your audience towards a certain experience or an idea or a thought, right? I'm going to literally take the last few minutes to I think at this point of time also I have spoken a lot, so I'm going to give you a little bit of an amusing video that I'm going to share, and I'm going to share a video from my arangetram. I was 1997, I think. I was 11 years old. But the reason I want to do it is less for the amusement factor. But this is the Natakuranji Varnam, Swami Nanandan Adimani, which I revisited much later when I came under Priyanti's training. I revisited and relearned the entire piece afresh. Okay, but this was one of the first Varnams I had learned and performed for my arangetram as well. Now, the piece, and I'm going to play just one sanchari, the same line from both of these performances. Of course, it is in no way a kind of a direct comparison. You know, there is 15 years between these two videos. But the intention is to show the structure. So I'd like you to just sort of pay attention to the structure that was followed in the Varnam that I did, you know, in my arangetram versus how that same idea was captured. And hopefully, for me, that's clearly what changed. When I said there was an embodied understanding of suddenly, okay, why am I enjoying this piece so much? But I can now, when I look back, I can put down all the points that I have, you know, today spoken about and say, tick, 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 right? The version that I'm doing now lends itself to all these ideas, right? Versus a very different approach that, you know, was presented to me when I was a child. So I'm just going to play that, and then afterwards we will just open out to the discussion and questions. So.
Thank you.
Much more, I will play for you the next question now. The same, and sorry, I think I forgot to explain the words. It is just saying your name, saying that one word, right, which is your name, is my entire life, and I believe that. I trust that, you know, that is my life. That's what the words are. Just finding it a bit difficult to navigate this. I don't want to, you know, the only interesting thing for me when I went back to the old video and I saw it is I was clearly very, very convinced about what I was doing. There was no lack of sort of involvement or conviction in what I was trying to portray. But I think that is the journey that has happened, right? It is not about conviction in me now being Markandeya, me now being Shiva, me now showing, you know, anger or sorrow or whatever, but being convinced about the picture that you are generating and, you know, for what purpose you're doing that. And I think that is definitely the journey that for me the Varnam has taken. But yes, open to questions, comments, thoughts, please. Love that.
Oh my God, amazing. I start off with my first question. Lavanya Shivram here, one of the coordinators for ICDA as well. Thank you very much, Reshma. Oh, I don't want this session to end for some reason, but then I don't know. Everybody has time constraints. So, Apoorva, ma'am, my question to you, like in the last piece that you showed us, it was definitely a distinction between teaching Varnam to a very young child than to a matured woman, right? So in all the things that you have said, is it that with age only we will be able to relish the Varnam or the Shringara more? Because at that particular age, we may not feel this emotion, so we may not have the connect. Is it a fair understanding?
So thanks so much, Lavanya. I think that's a very valid question. In this case, this is a Varnam that can actually be taken as a Bhakti Varnam also, right? Even though the common line is, Bhakti is kind of a Varnam based on Bhakti is more of a substitute, right? You always want to do a Shringara based Varnam. That's my point. I think any metaphor that works, works. And Swaminamanda Nadimai can be looked at as a Shringara Varna, it can be looked at as a Bhakti Varna. But that having been said, I don't, what I was trying to illustrate in this case is perhaps, I don't know how a 10 or 11 year old me would have responded to this choreography that I'm right now doing, because it is not, the ideas were very simple. The ideas are not complex as something that was beyond my mind as a 10-year-old to comprehend, because the focus stayed with the narrator's willingness to constantly say, in this case, Nataraja's name, right? I don't want food, I don't want sleep, I want to keep saying your name. It's not necessarily, if a 10-year-old can understand, Markandeya doing the japam of Shiva's name, this is not very far from that. So I don't think there needs to be, it affects the choices that we make when we teach very young people. You wouldn't want to take something that may lie beyond the comprehension of that person. I don't think it's a question of age, right? It's also a question of maturity and how much you're able to understand and process at that time. But it may not be necessary to change the format of what you're doing, right? The way it will be done at 10 is different from the way it will be done at 30 and 50. Right? I am sure 20 years down the line, I will look back at this video that I have now shown you and, probably laugh at it for, many reasons. But there is going to be that evolution with it. But it's not in the content and the structure that you, change it, right? Because that's when these sort of questions begin to arise as well. Like, if I am talking about, your name I want to keep uttering, how did suddenly that shift into a Sanchari about Markandeya? And then without explanation, it shifted back into a Tattamatta and went on to a Jati, right? And that's what I was talking. So what happens is that aspirational quality and putting yourself at the center of that aspiration was absent, right, in the first case. And it was a narrative quality. So you are kind of more playing with it in piecemeal rather than looking at it as a whole. I don't know if did I answer your question? Sorry, or did I just go away in a tangent?
Maybe not, but for some reason I liked the younger one's narration better. I don't know. Maybe I am just a 10-year-old trying to connect. Okay. So I'll just ask, rephrase this question, because I think this question will be in the minds of many teachers who are attending here. How can we teach Shringara to a youngster who has not experienced it? I hope it's a fair question to ask if everybody agrees. I don't want to take everybody's time.
First of all, the choice of whether or not you want to teach Shringara to a child is entirely yours. And I think it's something that one needs to make that decision based on, like I said, less the age, but more the maturity of the student, right? Why do we think it is absolutely valid to teach Mahishasuramardhini to a 10-year-old child, which is about vanquishing, about killing, right? About a certain level of anger that a 10-year-old does not comprehend, about evil, okay, which a 10-year-old does not comprehend. We don't ask the same question about teaching that to a 10-year-old, but somehow with Shringara alone we have our reservations. I just go back to the same thing. It is not possible that I will in my life experience everything that I portray in dance, and that is the beauty of it. Even today, I do a Mahishasuramardhini. I don't know what it feels like to vanquish or to kill or to have that great degree of anger. But I think what we're doing when we're teaching Abhinaya is training the ability to imagine. And I think a 10-year-old has a far higher imagination than most adults have. And it's not something that we need to, you know, hesitate about at all. All you have to teach them is to imagine that emotion, right? A 10-year-old has their own things that they love. They understand that emotion of love. And like I said, that's what you're getting to the core of, right? You're trying to get to the core of the emotion. And if you can find them a parallel that will get them there, that is the first step, right? And it's anything, absolutely anything that we then portray is going to evolve with them. But yeah, I feel like if we have reservations about teaching Shringaram, that then extends to practically every single thing that we will, you know, we ask our children to portray, I think. But, so it doesn't matter to me. Yeah.
Amazing. This answers. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Apoorva, while we gather our next question, a very open, your doorbell has been ringing. Do you want to attend to that?
No, that's fine. I know. I think it's my house help who is here, but that's fine. I informed me.
Right. So, yeah, there is Vaishnavi who was pinging, saying she has a question.
Hi. Namaste, everyone. And hi, Reshma. Reshma is my schoolmate, so it's a long time. Yeah. Apoorva, ma'am, I'm an ardent fan of yours, the upfront. I was just watching Indendu Vachati Vira just in the morning today. And it occurred to me, see, there are so many Nayikas, and we relate to each one differently, right? And there are certain set rules about what the Nayika Bhava is. But I may not emote the way the Khandita in Dendu could have been portrayed by a particular artist or even my guru. But for me, the emotions may be different, and the way I want to express is also probably different. And how much of this expression of this freedom of expression does an artist have? I mean, is it wrong to feel angry while you're supposed to feel remorse about it? I don't know. How much of a freedom does an artist have, keeping the rules of the Nayikas intact?
Thank you. Thanks, Vaishnavi. I think that's a great question. What the artist, and I think what each one of us as artists bring to the table is a certain individuality, right? And that goes without saying, because there is no way, even if I attempt it, I will comprehend what it means to you to feel anger or love, you know, versus my feeling of anger and love. So, and what we're doing in this transference process is only trying to, you know, get at that string, right? What is the string of love for you? Can I evoke that out of you? So definitely it is going to be individualistic. But can I feel anger where I must be feeling remorse? Is now what you're doing is, in saying something like that, you're bringing your personal preference into that space. It is not a question of emotion, right? Because then what you're asking is, oh, if a man does this, how would I feel about it? The question you want to ask is, this woman, this man, given the situation, given their background, right? What is that person's response is ultimately the question that you want to ask, right? But even then, when I play that response and when I play that anger, I am drawing anger from my understanding of anger only. And to that degree, your portrayal is constantly influenced by who you are to that degree, right? But can I say, for instance, oh, Sita should not have, you know, she should have walked away from Rama when he asked her to get into the fire. Well, the fact of the matter is she did not, right? And she stepped into the fire. So if I play Sita, I can't run away from the fact that that's what she did. And that's where my challenge as an artist lies, you know, in getting into the mind of another person. And I think that's a very It's a very underappreciated challenge, and also an, I think an underappreciated high. That high that you have when you are able to go away from yourself and actually slip into the shoes of another person. Like, the more you create that distance between you, right, and that person that you're playing, right, taking that journey is, I think, a very, very fulfilling one. So there is a subtle difference. Definitely, you are drawing from personal experiences of emotion. I understand jealousy, sarcasm, anger, love, because in some context, I have either felt it or I have seen it. But whether or not a character would act in a certain way is not something that I should transfer onto myself, right? And especially if you're dealing with a poem that has already been written, if you would like to create a situation based on how you would react, right, create a composition for that. So you have to create a composition afresh and not reinterpret an existing composition out of its context, right? Because it's, I would say also in one way, that's perhaps the easy thing to do also. And then the journey again kind of gets limited to me, you know? And there's only that much that I can be on my own. But that world that opens up to you when you can be 100 other people, I think is extremely fascinating. And does that make sense?
Yes. You put it so beautifully, ma'am. It takes a lot, and probably that is what the artists say when they evolve, I suppose. Right? Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Apoorva, I know we are overflowing, but if you could just take one question, there is one person who's asked.
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
Bhargavi,
please go on.
Hi, Akka. I hope you're doing well. I just wanted to say thank you so much for this presentation. I really enjoyed it. I just have one question. So as a Nayika in a Padavarnam, how do you know how comfortable you can be in the way you address the figure that you're talking to in the piece? Like, for example, in Yantanine Talupudra, the Nayika is a younger woman, so she can be a bit more playful in her approach addressing Lord Shiva. So, but for other Nayikas, like, how do you know the maturity level of that Nayika? Is it indicated in the lyrics or anything like that?
Thanks, Paragavi. Thanks for that question. These kind of, you know, ideas that come into the Varnam. So in the case of Yantanine, it says, I am a young girl. It's a cursory reference in one of the charanas, right? And it's not something to indicate her, you know, her personality to that degree, versus, you know, how you say, oh, poor me, right? Poor me, I'm innocent, I don't know anything, right? It's that kind of a statement when there is a reference in a Varnam to, am I not just a young girl? In the sense, am I not, there is a certain innocence that it reveals, right? But most often, you don't have references like this in the traditional Padavarnams at all. Neither in the quality of the words, nor in the exact descriptions. There are no exact descriptions that are provided at all that lets you peg onto the, the way this character and the degree of comfort the character will have in talking to the deity. And how much comfort do you have? I'll just put it back to you. See, if you're talking to a person that you know very well, that relationship determines the comfort. Okay? If you're talking to something that is in your imagination, you determine the comfort, no? I'm not talking to Tyagesha who is standing in front of me. I'm talking to my aspiration, Tyagesha. So I can be as close, as distant, as elusive, as playful as I want to be, as I choose to be. And I think the Varnams give you scope for, it does give you room to, you know, create different treatments out of it. And that is where, again, the sort of individual treatments of Varnams really come out. In my understanding, when I watch Varnams, why Varnams look so different when the same Rupa Mudruchi is done by 10 artists, it's just, it can look completely different from each other. You won't even believe you're seeing the same piece. It's because it has this space, right, of what each artist is bringing. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Apoorva?
Hi, yeah, Nicola, yes.
Hi, and I wanted to say two things. First of all, thank you for everything you said. Everything you said is, I feel like it's resonating inside of me, and maybe I'll need more time to understand and match it with the choreography we are doing and everything that I think I'll need time to fully understand what you said, but already in a certain way I already understood everything. But I had a question that it's more a curiosity. You said you asked the question to yourself as an artist. You said, what's my purpose to my audience? Oh, while, but I was curious to know in general, what's your purpose, especially when you're playing characters that you disagree with? Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Nicola. That's definitely a hard one. I think I'm still negotiating with that question in terms of what to me, what should be my responsibility as an artist, right? I don't think I've sort of pegged anywhere specific at the moment, but I'll share with you one thing, you know, that is more of a recent thing that I have realized. That, you know, the urge, the tendency is for all of us is to use art as a tool of expression, like use it to express ourselves, right? Our deepest selves, our emotions, our opinions, and things like that, which is great, which is fantastic. And I think we should do that. But perhaps what, in my sort of hazy understanding now that I see, is that to do that, there are so many other mediums you can use also, right? I can write, I can speak, I can do so many other things to simply talk or express my opinion, right? But what possibly I can do with dance, which I may not be able to do, I don't know. I mean, I'm just making this statement, you know, out of my understanding of dance. I may have a poorer understanding of writing or speaking. What I feel dance allows me to do is
okay. We do have a lot of comments. Everyone saying thank you to you. Yes, that's what I see most of it. I guess we probably wrap today. So Apoorva, I'm just probably going to summarize what everyone has already said. It's been an amazing session, and I think there's one thing that you taught all of us. It's not just that we need to aim at fineness in the technique of dance, but also fineness in our thinking and understanding of what we are doing. So I think that's what you've taught us today, to be a thinking dancer, not just a technically perfect dancer. Thank you. Thank you so much, Apoorva. It's just amazing to have you with us. Your thoughts, your ideas, the amount of understanding, just absolutely perfect. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure to, you know, be here. And like I always say, I wish these meetings would happen in person. That would be so much better. But still to, you know, have the opportunity to meet all of you and to have this conversation is absolutely wonderful. It's a learning for me every time when I do it as well. So thank you. Thank you, ICDA. Thank you, Reshma, for having me.